Now, unfortunately, I'm not going to post the solubility guidelines on an exam. But the thing I will give you is the KSP table. So this table and the KSP table are directly related. And what a KSP table does is it lists all, and I'm going to put quotes around this, insoluble salts from the solubility rules. So these two tables go hand in hand. If you have a KSP for a particular salt, then you could say it would be insoluble from the table that we were given. And this will tell us that a precipitate will form. You'll notice the KSP table lists a KSP value for mercury chloride. So if mercury were contained in this unknown solution, it would show up in the precipitate. If we had sodium plus ions in our unknown solution, you don't have a KSP value for sodium chloride. So therefore, it would remain an ion in solution. So I really want to emphasize that that KSP table can tell you a lot of information about the general solubility of all these ions in solution. Okay? So make sure that you're able to reference that as you're going forward. And there is a KSP table attached in your lab manual. We can now look at the various KSPs and look at molar solubility in a little bit different light. Our KSP for silver chloride is equal to 1.8 times 10 to the minus 10. For lead chloride, it's going to be equal to 1.7 times 10 to the minus 5. In certain flow charts and in certain schemes, silver is always contained in group 1, but sometimes we say trace amounts of lead are contained in group 2. We can go and we can look this up by calculating the molar solubility. You're going to be using 4-milliliter test tubes in your particular experiment. Okay? They're about, you know, this tall, about the width of a pencil. By the end of the qualitative analysis lab, you'll have a great indication in your mind of exactly what the volume of 4 milliliters will look like. Okay? You're going to be using these things over and over and over again. Okay? I'll note that these are disposable test tubes, so if they get dirty, you don't have to spend tons of time washing them out. You can throw them away in the broken glass container. So if we look at the molar solubility, I'm not going to write out the ice table to save time, but we could write an ice table for silver chloride. We have a 1-to-1 ratio of cation to anion, so our KSP is going to equal x squared, which equals 1.8 times 10 to the minus 10. And if we assume that x moles of silver chloride dissolves, our molar solubility is going to be 1.3 times 10 to the minus 5 molar for silver chloride. For lead chloride, since we have a 1-to-2 ratio of cation to anion, our KSP is going to be 4x to the third. That 4x to the third is going to be equal to 1.7 times 10 to the minus 5, and our x is going to be 0.0162 molar. So a lot of the times I like to kind of take a step back and say, what does this mean? What does it mean for the fact that the silver chloride has a molar solubility of 1.3 times 10 to the minus 5 and lead chloride has a molar solubility of 0.0162? in terms of what you guys are thinking in your mind, I don't think that you have a great grasp of the difference between those two concentrations and how drastic or how close this could be. What we typically think in our minds, though, is an amount in grams that I could dissolve in a particular volume of solution. So what we can do is we can go through and do a calculation, and we can look at the amount in grams that will dissolve per 4 milliliters of each of these substances. So I'm going to kind of take a more extended value of 1.35 times 10 to the minus 5 moles of silver chloride dissolving per liter, because that's what the X is, which is the molar solubility. If we multiply by 1 mole is equal to 143.36 grams of silver chloride, this tells us that we're going to have 0.00192 grams of silver chloride dissolving per liter. That's not very much silver chloride. And if we go one step farther and we multiply this times 0.004 liters or 4 milliliters, we can say that 7.7 times 10 to the minus 6 grams of silver chloride dissolves in 4 milliliters of aqueous solution. Let's think about this value for a second. If I told you to go into the lab and weigh out 7.7 times 10 to the minus 6 grams of silver chloride, how would you do it? Do you think that would be an easy task or a tough task? It's going to be really tough. Our balance doesn't even go to that many decimal places. So this is why, in certain respects, in Chemistry 121, we say that silver chloride is insoluble, because it's really, really tough to measure 7.7 times 10 to the minus 6 grams in 4 milliliters. So silver chloride, in most respects, we can say, is not really going to dissolve much at all. If we compare that to the lead chloride, we have 0.0162 moles of lead chloride that dissolve per liter. We can use the periodic table to determine the molar mass of PbCl2, which is 278.2 grams per mole, times the 0.004 liters. This gives us a value of 0.0180 grams of lead chloride that dissolved in 4 milliliters of aqueous solution. So in terms of the values that we calculated, the lead chloride is an easy measurable mass, but the silver chloride is going to be much, much smaller. So for this reason, for the difference in solubility, is that this is why lead 2 plus is sometimes included in group 2 but silver plus never is. Remember, go back to that first initial statement that I said. We group the cations based on their solubility characteristics. If lead chloride is really, really insoluble, it's going to be put in a group pretty much all by itself. This also tells us something, that if we really wanted to take all of the lead out of our solution, it's going to be a little bit more difficult to do than if we wanted to remove all the silver out of the solution. If we wanted to remove all the silver ions from our unknown, it's going to be really straightforward because we just add a little bit of chlorine and boom, everything precipitates out. The lead, you might have to do multiple steps to try to remove all those ions from that solution. Because remember, we have to isolate everything. If lead is present in your solution, it's going to cause you to get false positive tests later on down the line. So you must separate out or remove all of the lead from a particular solution. So this might take a couple more steps, or it might be a little bit more difficult than removing the silver. And this is the reason why. It's all based on the solubility characteristics and how much of that particular substance will dissolve. So does anyone have any questions on the calculations I did here, or, you know, the differences in the solubility of these guys? Yes?
Can you explain again how can you remove silver again?
How could you see what?
Remove silver.
So in turn, the question was, how do you remove silver from this particular solution? If you add the chloride ion, right, it's going to precipitate out silver chloride. Okay, you can look at the KSP table, and we see up here that silver chloride has a KSP of 1.8 times 10 to the minus 10. Okay, that's very, very insoluble, so you're going to be able to remove both of them out at the same time. We'll go through in a little bit more detail then how we have to separate those two. It's when you're using these qualitative analysis schemes, it would be great if we could take a solution, we could just remove the silver and then do a test for that. Then it would be great if we could go and we could just remove lead and then do a test for that. Then we're going to just remove nickel, then just remove copper. But the chemistry doesn't work that way. We have to come up with a more elaborate and a more detailed scheme in order to do that. Okay? In an ideal world, yeah, it would be awesome to just take this solution and remove the ions one by one. But unfortunately, I didn't make the rules in this ideal world, and we have to come up with some observations first and then start looking at the rules. Okay? So unfortunately, we can't isolate silver just by itself, but we can eliminate or isolate silver and lead and then separate those later. Okay? And I'll talk about how to do that here in a second.